You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. We lift our
welcome to chapel today. It's great to have you here with us for worship. If you're looking for the pin of prayer board today, it's over here on the Macintosh side of the room. Feel free to come up at the beginning of our reflecting time if you have something you'd like us to pray for. We're kicking off our series, Little Words, Big Meanings, today, talking about faith and what faith really means and what it looks like in our lives. There's so many opportunities for us every day to exercise our faith, but many times fear can get in our way. Fear of loss, fear of rejection, fear of being ridiculed, fear of failure, the list goes on. Even with all of these fears in our lives, God wants us to know that he doesn't leave us and he will never let us down. We have a God who frees us from fear, and there's nothing that has the power to keep us from him. Let's continue in worship this morning.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of
Is from Luke 17, verse 5 through 6. The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say this to a mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you."
All right. Thank you, band. Aren't they wonderful? They make the rest of us sound good. I don't know about you, but I need help some days. So we're beginning a new series today here in chapel, and it's hard to believe that we're this far into the semester that we can already be beginning our third series in the semester, but time flies when you're having fun. So we're starting this series called Little Words, Big Meanings. And when we got together as a staff to begin planning the semester and all the series that we were going to be doing, we talked about how there's certain words that are used in everyday language that have very specific Christian meanings, but that some of those words have been co-opted or changed in their definition in the way that the world uses them, and there are many examples of that. One of those is purpose. You hear the word purpose everywhere, and yet it has a very specific Christian meaning for us. Mission is very similar. Every company in the world, every organization has a mission statement, and yet for us as Christians, we have a very different understanding of what it means to be in mission. Evangelism or evangelist. I hear this a lot in certain circles where people will say, I'm an evangelist for whatever, and they'll name a product or they'll name a company or whatever. And it just always sort of grates on me a little bit because for a Christian, the term evangelism or evangelist has a very different meaning. And vision is another one. But we've chosen to focus on four little words that have specific meanings on the surface, seem to have a commonly understood meaning, but when you look at the way they are used in the Bible, those words take on a completely different meaning altogether. And so faith is our first one today. And then next week we'll talk about love, and then the third week is about grace, and the fourth week is about charity. We tried to keep each of the words to one syllable because it's supposed to be little words, but charity is a word that I think gets misunderstood so often in the world, but Christianity has a beautiful way of looking at charity that's actually related to our concept of love and of grace. So it kind of combines all of the aspects of what we're talking about. So over the next 4 weeks, including today, it's our hope that we will all be able to learn together about the true meaning of what these words mean for us as Christians, so that we can better live out our life in Christ with some integrity. So, with that said, let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for these little words that seem so insignificant, but when looked at from your perspective and through the eyes of faith, we see how terribly significant they are. We pray that as we learn about the meanings of these words, that you would inspire us to use these words in our daily language and to act them out in our lives. So God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our spirits gathered here be acceptable unto you through Jesus Christ, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So in this scripture passage that we heard this morning, Jesus' disciples come to him and say, Lord, increase our faith. Now there's nothing really in particular that has happened for the disciples to make this request, but it's one of a number of requests that the disciples make of Jesus, particularly in the Gospel of Luke, as they ask really for themselves, but also on behalf of those of us who are reading their words many, many years later. They're asking the same question that we all ask, Lord, increase our faith. Now that request, that question, has within it four implications that I want to look at this morning before we move on. The first implication is that faith is quantifiable, that there is a level of faith that you can have, that I can have more faith than you, or you can have more faith than the person next to you, or so forth and so on. I don't think faith works that way. I don't think it is quantifiable. I think it's one of those things that we try to quantify. We try to think, all right, I had very little faith before I was a Christian. Now that I've given my life to Christ, I've got a lot of faith, so therefore I've got more faith than I had before. It's a little fuzzier than that, though, I think, as we'll see as we look at this word. Second implication is that having more faith somehow makes things better for us. And by that I mean there's a misconception that we believe that if we just have enough faith that everything will go our way, that we'll get everything we've ever wanted, and that everything will be happy and sunshine and roses and unicorns and butterflies. But if you ask anybody who's been a Christian long enough, they will tell you that it is absolutely not the case. That the more you increase your faith, in fact, the more you learn about your faith, the more you get into your faith, the more difficult life sometimes becomes because all sorts of things will be thrown at you to try to knock you off that. And so we do struggle against an enemy that wishes to see us back away from our faith. So having faith doesn't make everything magically better in life, but it does help us to get through the things that life throws at us. The third implication is that faith is something that you possess. It's something that you can hold on to. It's like a thing you can lock away somewhere. And I think it's difficult to say that we can possess faith in and of ourselves because without God's help, we can't. It's very difficult to maintain our sense of faith, at least as we're going to talk about it today, if we don't have God's help. So for us to think that faith is something that I possess, that is individual to me, and that I am solely responsible for, is a fallacy. And that leads to the last implication, which is that faith is a human action. And that somehow we believe that faith is not a gift from God, which is what it is. Faith is about God's action in us, not about our action towards God. Remember that. Faith is about God's action in and through us, not about our actions towards God. Sometimes we get that mixed up, and we think that faith is all on us. But Jesus said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, he says that to his disciples, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed. Notice he uses the word had there. In other words, he's implying that the disciples don't have faith the size of a mustard seed. Now, that makes me get a little worried, because here are the 12 guys that Jesus chose to spend all of his time with. And here he is in the Gospel of Luke saying, even they don't have faith the size of a mustard seed. Lord, help me. Sometimes it's hard to imagine having faith even as much as a mustard seed, because sometimes it seems like it's very difficult to grasp onto that concept. Mustard seeds are very small, and the mustard seeds that Jesus was talking about were the kind that grew in Israel at the time that he was teaching. It was the black mustard plant, and the black mustard seeds are very, 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 very tiny, very small. And they're even smaller than what we think of when we think of mustard seeds. A little bit later, we're going to pass out cards that have a mustard seed taped to them so you can see the size of a mustard seed. But in Jesus' time, the mustard seeds he would have been talking about were even smaller than that. They were the smallest of all seeds. And so when we think about mustard seeds, we think about something that's difficult to hold on to. It's easy to lose. Your mustard seed could get lost. It could drop out of your pocket, or you could be walking along and it could slip out of your fingers and you could just lose it completely. Because mustard seed is so small, Jesus used this metaphor to show that our faith in God is required of us, but it is the minimum requirement. The minimum requirement is that we have faith in God, and that God will take that minimum requirement and do great things. If only we have faith. So you may have heard faith before being used as a synonym for belief. Some people think that faith and belief are the same thing. But I'm here to tell you this morning that they're not. Belief is an intellectual assent to something. We say, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in the Holy Spirit. And these are statements of our assent to those facts. I believe that God exists. That's a belief. It's an intellectual assent. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's a belief. It's an intellectual assent. I believe that the Holy Spirit is God's power and spirit moving among and through us. That's an assent to a fact. But to say that I believe in God and to say I believe God are two different things. Let me say that again. To say that I believe in God and say that I believe God are two different things. One says, I believe that God exists. The other one says, I trust. Now, there are some things that faith and belief share together. I love a good Venn diagram, don't you? So there are some things, there are some places where faith and belief come together, because you, after all, you do have to have some belief in order to have faith. You have to have something to have faith in. So first you have to believe in God so that you can have faith in God. So there are some places where those things intersect each other. But mere acknowledgement of the fact of God's existence is not the sum total of faith. And so I want to work with some images of faith this morning, which come to us from a couple quotations from some well-known Christian writers and theologians. First is from D. Elton Trueblood, who was a Quaker and was actually a college chaplain, so he must have been a really cool guy. He said, faith is not belief without proof, but trust without reservation. A lot of times, the way the world uses the word faith means that you have blind faith, that you believe without asking for any kind of proof. And so the thing that's often thrown back in our faces as Christians is, well, if you believe, if you have faith in God, then prove it. Show me the facts. Show me the figures. Show me the things that prove God's existence. But Elton Trueblood says that's not faith. Faith isn't belief without having any proof. It is trust without reservation. It's the kind of trust that allows you to put everything, all of your investment, all of your time and your energy into your relationship with God. And Martin Luther King Jr. said, faith is taking the first step even when you can't see the whole staircase. Faith means that we know God has built the rest of the staircase and that it will be there when we get to the top. But it's not having the facts right before us all the time. And so if we look at the history of how the word faith comes to us in our language, we see that faith begins in the Greek, in the version of this scripture where it's written in the Greek, the original language, the word is pistis, or pistis. And then that gets translated into Latin, fides. And then we translated that into English to mean faith. But if you go back to the original language, to Greek, it can not only mean faith, but it also means trust. Trust is different from belief. Belief says, I believe that God exists. Trust says, I believe God. It's hard for us to trust other people, isn't it? It's hard for us to trust ourselves. And sometimes it's hard to trust God, who is this supreme being who's out there somewhere, and it's hard, we can't touch God, we can't see God, we can't, you know, we don't have that physical presence of God with us. And so it's hard to have that trust. When I was in college, my freshman or sophomore year, I can't remember when it happened, but I was a member of STE at my undergrad institution, a place in Alliance, Ohio, known as the Purple Raiders. I apologize. But when I was at Mount Union, I was a member of STE. We called it STE. We weren't as cool as the guys here at Northern, so we called it STE. And we went on a fall retreat, and I think it was either my freshman or my sophomore year, but so this is like 1995 or 1996. I know, really ancient here. But we went on this fall retreat to a place that had one of those ropes courses where you do all these kinds of challenges and you climb up and down things, and it's supposed to help with your team building. And I was terrified going into this for a number of reasons. One, I was never a very athletic kid. I know, that's shocking to you. But I was also terrified of heights. And so I had never really enjoyed going up high on something, even if I was harnessed in the way that we were. And so we came to this thing called the Giant's Ladder, which is a little deceiving when you look at it, because it looks like it's kind of easy, because those first couple rungs are really close together, and you can accomplish those actually on your own. I did really well in the first couple rungs. But when you get to the third and the fourth and higher up, the rungs get slowly further and further apart. And there has to be two people on the Giant's Ladder, because by the time you get to the top, it takes both of you to get to the top of the Giant's Ladder. Now, you can imagine how terrified I was at the moment. And so I chose the tallest guy in our chapter to go with me. I was thinking. I'd seen some other guys do this. I took Mike Snyder with me, my friend Mike. And I figured if nothing else, Mike could make it up and I could find a way to get up as well. And we're climbing up the ladder, and it's kind of shaky, and there's two of us up there, and I'm exhausted because I'm not the most athletic person in the world, and Mike is just, you know, loping up because he's big and tall, he can do it. So he's like a rung or two ahead of me and calling to me to come on up, I'll help you up. And there's guys on the ground yelling instructions to me, which makes it worse. You know, if this was about team building, we weren't building a very good team, because they didn't understand that if you're yelling instructions at me, the last thing I want to do is follow your instructions. And so one of the guys who was an exercise physiology guy is saying, use your quads, come on, use your quads. I'm like, what is a quad? I don't know. And so I finally said, I don't think I can do this. And my friend Mike, who was just a rung above me, said, you can do it. And I said, no, Mike, I think I'm going to have to go back down. And Mike reached his hand down to me and he said, do you trust me? Do you trust me? Of course I trusted him. He was my brother in the faith and my brother in the fraternity. And So I was learning to trust him through this exercise. And so I reached up my hand, and basically Mike pulled me up the giant's ladder. But we got to the top, and when we got to the top, we were so elated that we had achieved this, mostly that Mike had achieved it and it helped me. But the way we were able to do it was by building trust, by Mike reaching out his hand and me having enough faith in him and his abilities to know that nothing was going to happen to me if I followed him. Having faith the size of a mustard seed is not about what we've been taught that it's about. We believe that having faith the size of a mustard seed is all about us, but actually having faith the size of a mustard seed is more about God than it is about us. Having faith is not about how much faith I can, or how much belief I can have without any proof, or about how much I can will myself to do anything. It's about how much I am willing to trust God in everything, in the same way that I was able to trust my friend Mike on the giant's ladder. You have the mustard seed. You have the mustard seed. Let God take care of the rest. Trust God through the good times and the bad, and God will pull you up the ladder. God will pull you up the mountain, or through the trials, or over the obstacles of life. Trust God. That is what faith is. It's as simple and as complicated as a mustard seed. So this morning we're going to pass out to you a little gift. And for our reflecting time, we're going to use these gifts. It's a little mustard seed along with today's scripture, and it's taped to a card. And we'd like you to take one of these. Oh, we're going to pass these out. Sorry. Yes, we're going to pass these out. I'm sorry. We're going to pass these out to you. So if we can get a couple people to help Caitlin, that would be wonderful. So if one person from each section could come over and help her grab some cards there. There's a scripture on there that's the scripture for today. The disciples asking Jesus for more faith, and he says, you know, faith the size of a mustard seed. You can move the tree from here to there. And I also want to make a reminder that while we're doing our reflecting time this morning, if you have a final prayer request that you'd like to give, make sure you come up here to the pin of prayer board during reflecting time, because we'll be praying after this. But everybody take a card, pass a card to a friend. We're going to use this for our reflecting. I think there's some others here. If you happen to not have one, we'll get you one. And if we run out, then that's a good thing. It means we had more people than we were expecting. So. Thanks, Sam. All righty. If you happen to not get one after they've all been passed out, look on with a friend. And we'll make sure that you get one later down the road. When you buy mustard seeds, you have to buy a whole jar, and there's like 2,000 of them. So we've got plenty of mustard seeds. Okay? All right. We're going to do a little guided meditation here with our mustard seeds. So you can look at it while you're thinking about this, and I'm going to guide you through a little bit of time of reflection on this. Take a look at your mustard seed. It's so small, isn't it? Yet within that seed is all of the potential to grow a whole new mustard plant. Mustard is a pervasive species. Once you plant it, it's hard to get rid of it. The seeds are so small that when the plant matures, they get everywhere. The birds eat the seeds. And when the birds fly away, they spread the seeds farther and farther afield. How is your faith like this mustard seed? There's a lot of potential in you, planted there by God before you were born. You have the ability to grow and to bloom and to spread God's love far afield. All you need is faith, trust. Trust in God, who will carry you through the trials and tests of life, who will give you strength when you need it most, who will never leave you nor forsake you. Can you trust God like that? Can you give God your faith, your trust? Can you have confidence that God will be there with you every step of the way? Take a few moments now to ask God to increase your faith, your trust in Him, and to pray for faith in all that is to come in life. Oh Lord, increase our faith. Amen.
All right, we got some prayer requests today for a friend in her job search. She is having financial troubles and her job interview has just been canceled. So if you'd all please bow your heads. Dear Lord, I'd like to thank you for us being able to come together today and take a break out of what's been a stressful week as we finish our last push to fall break and then the end of the semester. Please be with one of our friends as she's having financial troubles and her job search. Those of us who are leaving this year know the reality all too well of the job search, as it's the sum of our time here and the burden of the real financial world and all those crippling student loans. Dear Lord, please be with those of us who are traveling home over break. Safe travels for everyone, whether the trip be 20 minutes or 20 hours. Please keep us all safe as we head home to see our families and refresh ourselves before the last push towards the end of the semester. It is in your name we pray, in Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, so for what's next today? Okay, so there's Pancake Procrastination 2.0. That'll be Thursday, October 8th in the Chapel Lounge from 9:30 to midnight, and it's $5 for all-you-can-eat pancakes. Hot chocolate and coffee are provided, and pancakes are with or without and without chocolate chips. Yeah, that's tonight. Thanks. And then the second annual Chili Cook-Off. The proceeds will go to towards World Vision, which is the organization that organizes the 30-hour famine and strives to end world hunger. And that'll be Saturday, October 17th from 4:30 to 7 in the chapel. Two bowls of chili for $3 or unlimited chili and sides for $5. Proceeds are going to North Korea to help end childhood hunger. So if you have any questions, you can email. They have their own email at onu.chilicookoff@gmail.com, or you can join them on Facebook at ONU 30-Hour Famine or follow them on Twitter at ONU Famine. And that's all I've got.
All right. Thank you, Brittany. And your very own chaplain will have a pot of chili in the chili cook-off, so come and taste it and vote for it, most importantly. Please stand for the benediction and our closing song. Go now in peace and not in pieces, for God has called you to trust Him. Will you go and trust Him with faith, even faith the size of a mustard seed? Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today to worship and grow. Next week, we'll be continuing our series, Little Words, Big Meanings, which you won't want to miss. Grab some more food on your way out, enjoy your fall break, and we will see you next week.